Hello, Desert Springs Church. It's so good to see you again. Let's go ahead and stand and prepare to worship our Lord. This is for the ones who have decided to follow Jesus. A one, a two, a one, two, three, four. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, oh, no turning back. I have decided. I have decided to follow Jesus. Turning back, oh, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, oh, no turning. That's right, church. No turning back. No turning back at all. Here's a beautiful song about our merciful God entitled Lord Have Mercy. A one, two, three, four. Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken. Promises that burn within my heart have now grown dim. With a doubting heart I follow the paths of earthly wisdom. Forgive me for my unbelief, renew the fire again. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me. I am built not where I worship things of man. I have taken journeys that have drawn me far from you. Now I am returning to your mercies ever flowing. Pardon my transgressions, help me love you again. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Tender mercies like a river of forgiveness ever flowing without end. I bow my heart before you in the goodness of your presence. Your grace forever shining like a beacon in the night. Lord, Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, thank him for his mercy. Amen. On this last one, if you don't mind standing one more time, this is all about our Redeemer lives. One, two, one, two, three, four. I know he rescued my soul. Blood has covered my sin. I believe, yeah, I believe. My shame he's taken away. My pain is hidden in his name. I believe, I believe, yeah, yeah. I'll raise a banner. Conquered the grave, my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. Yeah, yeah. Come on, y'all, let's worship the Lord this morning. I know he rescued my soul. His blood covered my sin. I believe, yeah,
We're so glad you're with us, joining us online for worship here at Desert Springs. And you can join us every week, all summer long, anytime at visitdsc.org here on the main page. Let other people know, and they can join us as well. And of course, we are open again here on Monterey Avenue at 8, 9:30, and 11 a.m. worship times, and with our Refresh Contemporary Service at 11 a.m. as well. Also with ministries for kids and youth during the 11 o'clock hour. And I'm so excited that senior adult class is back. Online on Zoom, and you can be part of the senior adult, the class, every Sunday afternoon at 4 p.m. Maybe you've been thinking about checking it out and you haven't done it yet. This is a great way to see how you like it, and I know you're going to like it when you tune into Zoom on your computer or your phone or your tablet at 4 p.m. each Sunday. Now, you're going to need a passcode to get in on the class, and when Zoom asks you for the passcode, you want to type in 838-400-5-4250. Grab a pencil or a pen. I'll repeat that passcode again in just a moment for you. Meanwhile, remember you can use that prayer request large round button right on our main page at visitdsc.org to send in your prayer requests. Let us know how we can pray for you. We're praying for many people. I'll pray for you. I'll be sharing this with our intercessory prayer team. We will pray for you, our pastoral team, and God bless you through this transitional time of the COVID-19 virus. And then thank you so much for giving. We appreciate your support sincerely. As the church moves forward well during this time, you can give, of course, right here on our website. Just click the large tithes and offering round button, if you would, please. And you can give by a check. Information is there for how to do it. You can give immediately by credit card, or it also instructs you in how to set up automatic pay deduction from your account. So God bless you. Thank you for your generous support and your tithes and offerings. We appreciate it. And as I promised again, if you'd like to check out the class, Senior Adult Ministry Sunday School, today at 4 p.m. each Sunday on Zoom, use passcode 838-400-5-4250. And you're going to enjoy it, so get in on that. Now would you bow with me, and we're going to pray together before our message. So Heavenly Father, thank you for the many blessings you give to us in our lives. Today, Lord, we just want to say we love you. And it's, Lord, sort of hard to believe we're already almost halfway through the month of July as we get together today to worship you, to put you first in our lives. And so we thank you for your faithfulness to each one of us, for how you're guiding us every step of the way. And Lord, today we do lift up to you each one who is ill, each one who's facing medical need. Lord, we pray your healing and strength in their lives. Lord, we pray for each one who's suffering just emotionally and feeling isolated and alone and lonely. Would you encourage them and provide others in their lives and help them to reach out? And then, Lord, we pray for those who are facing a struggle financially and maybe in their work or in their business. Lord, we pray your blessing and your help. And we thank you that you are our provider. You're our rock. You're our shelter and our strength. And Lord, today we love you and we worship you. And Heavenly Father, how we pray for our nation, how we pray that we would be one nation unified under God, Lord, under you, the living God. And so we ask, Lord, in this election year, that you would please raise up and cause those to win the elections, Lord, across our country, who would enact laws that honor you and that support your commands. And Lord, may we be a people who follow you and live for you and be blessed by you. Forgive us, Lord, and help us, we ask. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, again, thanks for joining us. For these 2 weeks, we're going to be having a part one and a part two. Today, of course, is part one on a topic that I think really fits this unusual, challenging season of the COVID-19 virus. I'm calling this Growing Strong in Trying Times. Growing Strong in Trying Times. So today is part one. And over these 2 weeks, we're going to be looking at a familiar text in Scripture from the book of James, James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. And so if you have a Bible with you or an app for the Bible on your phone or tablet, you can turn your Bible on or open your Bible up to James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. We'll be getting to that in a few minutes. You know, the book of James is loaded with amazing statements of transformational truth from God's Word. And it's God's Word to us. And when we apply it, it will literally turn our lives around. So the Bible's more than simply worth the read. It is worth applying. And then just watch what God will do through your life. Now, our takeout verse for the week is the first half of the statement of James 1, verse 22, where it says, "Prove yourselves doers of the word." So we're not just to hear the word, we're to apply it personally. We're to do it, to get after it. And this is going to be very true in our message today, and again with part two next Sunday. So be sure to come back on the website next Sunday, anytime. Next Sunday, to hear the second half of this message. James 1, verses 22 through 25, for background, say, "But prove yourselves doers of the word, and not merely hearers who delude themselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But the one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this person shall be blessed in all they do." And that's what we want to do, is be the doers who are blessed in life, for following God's word is instruction manual for a healthy, joyous life in Him. Well, the book of James urges us to apply its content, and literally to apply all of Scripture's content in a personal manner. This is one of the strongest statements in all of the Bible for really getting on the stick with God and His Word and actively engaging it. And believer, receive it. Receive God's instruction into your life, and then chew on it, and finally swallow it, so that you can benefit from its nutrients to make you strong in the Lord, in our Savior Jesus Christ. So here we go with our topic, growing strong in trying times. Growing strong in trying times. I think it goes without saying that we're in a very challenging time right now. It's challenging for every single one of us in various ways. And I think we could all use some good news. I don't know, you could be frustrated right now, tired, fearful, angry, becoming upset. Whatever your mood and whatever you face in these trying times, I want to assure you that God is with us. He doesn't just sit back and watch from a distance. And so you can call out to Him with your need, and you can look forward in faith to His loving answer. So when you call out to the Lord, expect Him to respond to you, believer. Don't just call out saying, well, I kind of hope maybe somehow something will happen from all this. Go to Him sincerely and say, loving Lord, I know You care for me. I know You're listening, and I need Your help. And then just watch what God can do for you. Understand, in trying times, God wants us also to glean the best from every tough situation. In trying times, God wants us to glean the best from every tough situation. So enter Jesus, who came into our world to preach good news, to offer true peace and lasting hope and a promising future. And He's the only one who can deliver on all of that in our lives. And He delivers on time and on schedule. And He has good news for you. Good news for you, no matter your present situation. So don't lose hope. You might have lost hope in your situation. You might have lost hope in your personal resources. You might have lost hope in this world. But don't lose your hope in the living God. He's the one who won't let you down. Look to Him. Now, Luke chapter 4 describes the fulfillment of the prophecy found in Isaiah chapter 61. As now, so many years later, from the time of the penning of Isaiah chapter 61, Jesus comes into His hometown of Nazareth, and He enters the synagogue, as described in Luke chapter 4, and He reads these words. Listen. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who were downtrodden, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. This is why Jesus has come, to rescue us, and He has declared it. So if the Lord has come to rescue us, which He has, why all of this hardship? Is His plan not working? Did He have a system failure and the hard drive isn't rebooting? Is God too weak to deliver on His promise of rescue? Or is it all heavenly hype to just try to encourage us in a very hopeless situation? Well, central to our understanding of God and believing in His one and only Son, Jesus, is addressing this ultimate question. If God is real, which He is, and if He sent His Son into our world to rescue us, which He did, then why hardship? Why hardship? And if you're using your message notes right now, you can download them right there on the main page by the note date. There at visitdsc.org on the main page, and you can print them out and follow along. That's our first thing to fill in on your notes. Why hardship? That's a question that's been asked through the centuries. And maybe you recall a well-selling book for many, many years. Why do bad things happen to good people? How could a loving God, in other words, allow pain and difficulty in a world that He says He loves and cares so much for? And why would He allow His own Son to come into this imperfect world and then to wind up being crucified? Well, the pieces of this discussion at surface level really don't seem to fit together. But you see, the Bible teaches us and instructs us regarding this important matter. The Bible says God is not to blame for the trying times of our lives. We find within this same book of Isaiah the one Jesus read from in his own hometown to announce his coming to be the Savior of the world, we find in the same book of Isaiah the answer to the reason for our hardships in life. In Isaiah 53, verse 6, it says, "All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him," to fall on Jesus. The Bible teaches that we've all gone against God. We have disobeyed him, every single one of us. I have, you have, we all have. And that has brought sin into our world, into our lives, and sadly, into our daily life experience. We read again in Isaiah 59, verse 2, "But your iniquities have made a separation between you and God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear." So God sent his only Son, Jesus, to come and to suffer and to die on the cross for you and for me. Jesus took our sin, our punishment for living against God. And then he rose from the dead on the third day to demonstrate that the payment for our sins has been fully made. By simply inviting Jesus to come into our lives and forgive us, to be willing to turn from our sins to live for him and say, "Lord, come in my life, forgive me. I believe you died for me and rose again." The Bible says by doing that, we can become right with God. Simply by believing, having faith that Jesus is who he claims to be, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. So we read in Isaiah 45, verse 22, God says, "Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is no other." Now, when we decide to come to personal faith in Christ, what I've just described for us, then God comes into our life, he forgives us of all our sins, and he promises to help us in life. We already have an assurance of heaven when we accept Christ. We have the joy of being forgiven by God. And now we can have the confidence that God will help us. He will rescue us. He will go with us through life. Psalm 91:1 says, "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty." Isn't that great? Yet, even our passage, which we will get to in just a moment in the book of James chapter 1, confirms that when we are saved through believing in Christ, yet there remain troubles in this world, which we will still invariably face. Now, some trying times which come into our lives are so severe that we need to simply bow the knee before our God and accept that he alone has divine authority. Psalm 103 declares, "The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his sovereignty rules over all." And we read again in the book of Philippians, chapter 2, "God highly exalted Christ and gave him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every person, everything, and everyone under the earth, above the earth, and upon the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." You see, some trying times that come into our lives are more than tough. They're extreme. They're severe. And those are the times we need to simply humble ourselves before God, the only one who is in charge, and worship him. We do not receive all the answers to our trying times in this world. Now, God bless you if you're facing a most severe time in your life. Go to the Lord, worship him even when you don't understand, and he will lift you up and give you peace. Now, this brings us to the bedrock of our passage here. The whole point of James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, And there are those difficulties and those seasons of life which make us all wonder, where'd God go? I'm having a trying time here. And into that, I would just like to read for you our text, James 1, verses 2 to 4. This is from the New Living Translation. I love the way it puts it. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. Now, God's Word reveals to us at least four sources for trying times. And what the book of James has just described to us is that God can use trying times for good in our lives. But let's back up a moment, because again, we've got 2 weeks on this topic together, part one and part two. And we want to back up and talk about the sources of trying times in our lives. And I believe there are at least four, and I'd like to outline those for you today. The first is, we can experience hardship due to ourselves, Now, this is sort of a no-brainer. It's a, of course, kind of moment. There are times we all fall short in life. We don't sort of measure up. At times I get upset with myself and I say, I can't believe I did that, or I can't believe I didn't do that. Oh, my goodness. Sometimes we just have to point the finger for the hardship right back in our own direction. Galatians 6:7 says, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he shall also reap. So this is the spiritual principle the Bible gives us, that sometimes we cause our own demise, so to speak. Sadly, many times we want to blame God or someone else for our own faults, our own weaknesses, our own shortcomings, our own mistakes, our own addictions. And I think that a big part of this is taking responsibility when something is our own error, and fessing up to it, and then admitting it. And I think that's 90% of the battle right there. As long as, along with admitting it, you also forgive yourself. And you say, it was serious, I shouldn't have done it, or I should have done the right thing, I didn't do the right thing, but I'm going to forgive myself, and I'm going to improve here. I'm going to take a new crack at this thing. And that's about 90% of the battle right there. And then you just invite the Lord. You confess it to Him. Lord, you know what happened, and I take responsibility. Forgive me. Would you help me? Would you rescue me in this situation? So don't be a person who goes through tough times that they always blame on everyone and everything else, and even blame God for. Now, this is not the only reason we can go through tough times, but I will just say finally on this first point, if you've been facing a tough time in your life and it's your own doing, admit it, but then forgive yourself. Don't torture yourself over it. None of us are perfect people, and God loves you, and He wants to help you in life. So forgive yourself, and maybe you need to ask a few other people to forgive you if it's impacted them as well, and then you can move forward together in positive steps, and the Lord can help you. It can be so freeing when we admit our own failures, and we can move on well. I know it takes some humility, takes a little humbling, and sometimes admitting it to others is even tougher. Admitting it to God can be tough, but it's the right thing to do, and it'll bless you. Secondly, we can experience hardship due to living for Christ. Did you know that, believer? You know, sometimes we are new in the faith and we accept the Lord. We just think everything's going to be rosy, everything's going to go great, and Lord willing, a lot will go great when you accept the Lord. I mean, you're forgiven of your sins. He gives you a peace in your spirit. You have the joy of knowing you have eternal life. God is with you to help you. There's so many things in life that God, I believe, saves believers from and rescues believers from. And we've been praying for a young lady in our church, and she had a very serious cancer diagnosis, and then the Lord's healed her and delivered her. Praise the Lord. So there are so many times when I sense, you know, that God kept me from something because He loves me. He's watching out for me. How many times have you been on the freeway and you said, oh my goodness, God, please help those people. And thank you, Lord, that you protected me from the accident. So God rescues His children, those who know the Lord Jesus, from so many things. But you know, there's a flip side to that. And that when you live for the Lord, sometimes you will suffer because of your faith in Jesus Christ. We call that persecution for your faith. Now, it can be direct. It can be someone at work who doesn't like the fact that you love the Lord Jesus and you're doing the right thing by living a transparent life, and they know that you know God and that you're honoring God with your life. It's going to show anyway if you're honoring the Lord, because you're not going to be swearing up a storm, and you're not going to be having a bad attitude all the time, and you're not going to be going around blaming everybody all the time, and you're not going to have a harsh spirit. And they're going to say, wow, what's with them? And then they'll learn that you know the Lord. And some people won't like that, and they might give you a hard time for it, or take away job opportunities, or not give you work advancement, or not give you the contract or the agreement or what have you, because you're a believer in Christ. But there's also persecution that can come from the spiritual realm. In Ephesians chapter 6, if you want to do a little homework on your own, read Ephesians 6, and it talks about the spiritual war we're in, that when we honor the Lord in our life, the devil doesn't like it, and he wants to attack us in life. But you know, we just got to stand strong in the Lord and keep living for Jesus. 2 Timothy 3:12 says, indeed, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution, will be persecuted. So you say, well, Mark, I can't believe I'm having a hard go of it in the Lord. Well, praise the Lord, because Jesus suffered for us. What an honor that we could just have a little bit of suffering compared to all He did for us to honor Him. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verses 11 and 12, that when we are persecuted for following Him, we should be excited about it. We should rejoice. Praise God. We're in good company when we suffer for Jesus, and God will reward us for it. So I have to say that while persecution can come from others, it can also come from society in general. It's not a real popular thing to be a believer in Christ in our nation right now. Hey, live for the Lord anyway. Do the right thing anyway. And again, as I said, it can come from spiritual forces working against us. But would you rather suffer for living against God, or would you rather suffer in living for the Lord? I'd rather suffer, if I need to, living for the Lord. How about you? Thirdly, we can experience hardship, trying times in our lives, due to correction. Due to correction. Now, I'm not just talking about getting a speeding ticket. I think that applies under point one today, that what you sow, you reap. You know, if you want to drive way over the speed limit, you may have to pay a fine of a lot of money. And I think the price for speeding keeps going up even higher and higher. But you can't complain to God if you get a speeding ticket for disobeying the law and going way too fast and endangering other people's lives. But that probably fits under point number one. But the kind of correction I'm talking about here specifically is what I would describe as godly discipline. Godly discipline. So how many of you, I'm just going to raise my hand, like, because I can say I have. How many of you watching right now, viewing this, have ever felt like you were disciplined by the Lord? That He ever had to kind of get you back in line a little bit? You know, your rod and your staff, they comfort me, from Psalm chapter 23. And you feel like the Lord had to give you a little whack, or maybe a big whack, to get you in line to honor Him in life. Have you ever been disciplined by the Lord? I have. And you know what? It's because He loves you, believer. because He cares about you. You know, if you study children and their child-reared lives, you will find that kids who are disciplined by loving parents, they grow up much more secure, they grow up happier, they grow up more healthy because someone has cared enough to help straighten them and guide them in life. It is the unloving parent that doesn't discipline their child. Now, I'm not talking about being unduly harsh or cruel with your children, but you know, God loves us so much, He's willing to discipline us to help us live for Him because He wants to bless our lives. He wants to grow us in Him and rescue us from the dangers, the things we'll fall into or go against Him in that could really damage our lives. And so He loves us. Proverbs 3:12 says, "For the Lord corrects those He loves." So if you ever feel corrected by the Lord, what an honor for that trying time in your life. And then in Hebrews 12, verse 6, in the New Testament, it says, "For those whom the Lord loves, He disciplines." He disciplines. So God warns us in His Word that He does correct us when we truly need it. And He has the ability to get our undivided attention. Believer, He loves you too much to leave you alone. And so if you're in a trying time and you really don't know why, could it be that perhaps the Lord is disciplining you to get your attention so that you would honor Him in your life? A loving parent disciplines, not to tear apart, but to build up. Fourth, and we'll be through for this first half of this topic of growing strong in trying times, we can experience hardship due to this world. In Luke 13, verses 4 and 5, Jesus said, "Do you suppose that those 18 on whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them were worse culprits than all the men who live in Jerusalem? I tell you no, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish." What Jesus was explaining there in that text to the people who are listening is that we live in a fallen world. Things are not as they were created by God to be. In society, in natural calamities which occur, and even through other people around us who can afflict and bring harm into our lives and into the lives of those we love. I think that the present trying times we're experiencing, which come from COVID-19, reveal the struggle of life in a fallen world. And hardship can happen to all of us in a sinful world that's gone wrong. Thank God He can redeem our lives and use even the hard times, the trying times, to build us up in our faith. And our passage today reminds us it isn't a question of if we will have difficulties, but when trying times come, what will we do with them? I want you to know, believer, God's with you in the middle of all of it. Jesus said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." You never face what you face alone when you know Jesus Christ. Remember, Jesus was with the disciples in that rocking boat in the storm, and it was about to sink. And He didn't walk away. He could have. He could have walked right out back onto the stormy water and just left them out there to sink. No, instead, He stayed on that cushion in the back of the boat very quietly, simply waiting for them to begin to learn to trust in Him. So, believer, if your boat's rocking right now, if you feel like God's being silent in your life, while your situations go up and down, and you may even feel like you're sinking, I want you to know God's with you. And what He's saying to you is, trust me. Turn things over to me. Look in my direction, and let me help you. That's what the Lord's speaking into your life. Don't be angry with the Lord. He came to rescue you, to deliver you. This life experience is not all there is. This is just the waiting period before eternity. and you can be with the Lord forever in heaven. So don't misunderstand the Lord. He's come to make things right. He's come to take action. But you see, he's being patient, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so the Lord loves you. He can do great things for you, and you can trust him for it. So rest in the Lord and wait on him and realize you're never alone. Commit to him what concerns you and ask for his help and his supply. And God will work in all the things for the best for you and help to strengthen you in your faith and build you up in your character and give you greater resolve in your faith, knowing that if God is for you, who can be against you? Believer, in every tough circumstance you face, you can depend on your God. Would you bow with me and we'll pray? So Heavenly Father, thank you for how you love us, for how you promise to be with us, and for how you can be our comfort, our strength, the one who renews us, the one who is the lifter of our heads, the one who provides for us, the one who blesses and protects us, the one who is closer as a friend than anyone else, the one who longs to be actively a part of our daily life experience. God, we confess that at times we get worried, we panic, we're hurt, we're crushed, and we just take it all into our own hands. God, we want to turn it over to you because we love you, because you always know what's best, and because you care so much for us, Heavenly Father. You gave your own Son, Jesus, to die for us. And so we pause now, even in the things of life we can't understand, and we just say we love you. Lord, bring healing and hope to us, we pray, because you are our everlasting hope. Now, if you're listening right now and you've never invited Jesus to come in your life, I want to tell you, you can accept him in your life right now. The Bible says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. That's in Isaiah 55, verse 6. And this is your time to realize that God loved you so much, he gave his only Son, Jesus, to come to earth, be born as a man, yet fully God, to live a perfect life, and to be our perfect sacrifice for our sins. You say, well, Mark, you don't know what I've done. No, I don't need to know. God knows. And he loves you so much, his Son paid for every one of those sins. Not only the things you've done wrong already, but the things you're going to do. And God loves you so much, Jesus shed his blood to pay for every one of those things. But you need to say yes to the Lord Jesus. You need to say, Lord, I confess to you that I'm a sinner. I'm willing to turn from my sins, to receive you in my life. Help me to live for you and come in my life and forgive me. And if you're willing to do that, you can accept him now. I'll lead you in a prayer, and God's listening. And you can just talk to the Lord and settle it. It's the most important decision, the best decision you'll ever make in your life. Believe me. Or if maybe you've attended church for years, or you just flipped onto this on the internet by chance, let me tell you, you can use this as your prayer of recommitment to Christ as well if you're not quite sure where you stand with God. So talk to the Lord now if you need to and settle it. Just pray, dear Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me. I believe you're God's only Son, that you died for my sins on the cross, and that you rose from the dead, so I can live with you forever in heaven. Please forgive me of everything and come into my life right now. I'm willing to turn from my old ways to live for you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, God bless you if that was your prayer. Thanks for joining us. If you just email us here at the church, our information is at the bottom of the main page. I have a booklet we'd love to send to you in Living for the Lord. We'll just send it out to you, no obligation. Come back, join us again next week for our second half of Growing Strong in Trying Times, and we'll have some practical application we can apply to our lives. But keep hope. The Lord is for you. He loves you. He cares about you. And God can do anything, the impossible, in your life if you'll ask Him and you'll let Him. Trust Him and watch what He will do for you. God bless you. Would you stand where you are right now from wherever you're viewing this? And let's have a closing prayer of blessing together. Now may God bless you. May God keep you. May God make His face shine on you. And may God be generous to you. May He give you His peace. And may God give you the assurance of His deep love and abiding care upon your life. Amen. God bless you, and see you next Sunday.